The Cuban Missile Crisis was a harrowing conflict between the Soviet Union and the United States over placement of Soviet intercontinental ballistic missiles in the communist country of Cuba. Their discovery led to a naval quarantine and military standoff. The world was never closer to World War III. The animosity between the two conflicting parties, one focused on democracy, the other engrossing communism, almost sent the world into oblivion. The two nations' leaders, Kennedy from the United States and Khrushchev of the Soviet Union, deceived their own governments in a desperate attempt to defuse the conflict. Eventually, these machinations led to a secret compromise ending the standoff.
Good evening, my fellow citizens. This government, as promised, has maintained the closest surveillance of the Soviet military buildup on the island of Cuba.
On March 12, 1947, in the Truman Doctrine, President Harry S. Truman proclaimed that the U.S. should support Turkey and Greece to prevent them from falling to the Soviet Union. It was believed that if Turkey and Greece fell to the Soviets, then the surrounding countries would follow. This was known as the domino theory. Although the Soviet Union was never directly mentioned in the doctrine, it was clear that they were the center of the proclamation. This event is generally considered to be the beginning of the Cold War. The Cold War would eventually reach its climax in the Cuban Missile Crisis. On October 14, 1962, an American U-2 spy plane revealed that missile sites were being built on the small island of Cuba. This triggered a response in President John F. Kennedy, ultimately leading him to decide to commence a blockade on Cuba. However, according to international law, a blockade is considered to be an act of war. The Kennedy administration believed that this would not provoke the Soviet Union enough for them to attack.
To halt this offensive buildup, a strict quarantine on all offensive military equipment under shipment to Cuba is being initiated. All ships of any kind bound for Cuba, from whatever nation or port, will, if found to contain cargoes of offensive weapons, be turned back.
On October 22, 1962, Kennedy formally announced the discovery of the missiles to the nation. Earlier, the press questioned Kennedy about Cuban missiles, but Kennedy told them to hold their reports until he announced it himself. In this announcement, he established many things, the most important being the consideration of any missiles fired in the direction of the United States to be an act of war. If this occurred, it would result in a full retaliation against the Soviet Union, leading to a nuclear war. Kennedy also announced the blockade of offensive weapons to the nation.
Public reaction varied during the time, but the common reaction was fear. The government somehow needed to quell the fear, so it would not lead to a hysteria. Thus, they made the duck and cover exercise in case of a nuclear attack. While in reality, this would do nothing, the citizens of the nation were given a false sense of security. The public view on the crisis varied as well. A common mindset at the time was better off dead than red. Most of the public would rather die than have the Soviet Union take over. Many other people said that the U.S. should obliterate the Soviet Union. They would not be able to do anything they wished if they were destroyed. The public all agreed, however, that we should take action against the Soviet Union before they took action against us.
On October 26, 1962, a letter arrived from Nikita Khrushchev, Premier of the Soviet Union, the first one promising the dismantling of the missile sites only if Kennedy would lift the blockade on Cuba and give his word that the U.S. would not invade Cuba. The next day, another letter arrived for Kennedy, again from Khrushchev. This time, the letter called for the dismantling of the American missile sites in Turkey. As all this was happening, an American U-2 plane was shot down over Cuba. This was the crisis point, as it seemed as if a war was inevitable.
The purpose of these bases can be none other than to provide a nuclear strike capability against the Western Hemisphere.
Kennedy would overlook the plane incident. Also, the second letter of Khrushchev was ignored. Kennedy wrote back to Khrushchev, explaining that he would agree to not invade Cuba if the missile sites were dismantled. What the public did not know was that Kennedy had also agreed to the dismantling of the missiles in Turkey.
On October 28th, Khrushchev agreed to the deal put forth by Kennedy. Since the secret compromise was not made public, this made it seem as if the Soviet Union was retreating from something they themselves had started. Regardless, the closest the world has ever been to a nuclear war was averted. It's hard to believe that the Cuban Missile Crisis was only part of the Cold War, the climax.
Since the close of hostilities, the Soviet Union and its agents have destroyed the independence and democratic character of a whole series of nations in Eastern and Central Europe. It is this ruthless course of action and the clear design to extend it to the remaining free nations of Europe that have brought about the critical situation in Europe today.
After the Cuban Missile Crisis had occurred, it seemed as if it was a partial betrayal by the Soviets to Cuba. All of the decisions in the crisis were made exclusively by Kennedy and Khrushchev. Although the Cubans were protected from an invasion, they had no say in any of the matters during the crisis. The crisis ended peacefully without a confrontation, a great success compared to what could have happened. Step out of line,
the
man come and
take you away. We better stop. The events of the Cuban Missile Crisis caused many precautions to be taken in case of a future emergency. One such precaution was the creation of the Moscow-Washington hotline, which provides a direct communication between Moscow and Washington, D.C. This hotline allows the leaders of the U.S. and Russia to communicate directly in order to handle a similar situation better. This would hopefully make sure that another standoff would never occur in such a fashion. Although the crisis ended without it escalating out of control, there was opposition to the negotiation. Many U.S. military commanders were not happy at all. They demanded that the U.S. invade Cuba immediately. General Lee May even called it the greatest defeat in our history. Luckily, their aggressive suggestions were ignored. Thus, the world is at peace again, thanks to a negotiation between Kennedy and Khrushchev.